Let's begin again. Let's start over from the start. Let's forget the time that you really broke my heart. Everywhere within again. Let's begin again. Let's begin again. Let's forget about our pride. Pay attention to the way we feel inside. Let's give love a spin. Let's begin.
Films with sandcastles. You get a bunch of mates and you go down and you say, I'm going to build this great sandcastle, and you build it. Then the tide comes in and 20 minutes is just smooth sand. And that structure you made is in everybody's memory, and that's it. Fearless.
Coming in on a wing and a prayer. Coming in on a wing and a prayer. Oh, there's one more above we can feel. Coming in on a wing.
I grew up in Kansas City. When I was 18, I became a flyer, and I went overseas in the South Pacific. I started writing letters, and I wrote a letter to a cousin of mine who was a woman who I didn't know really, but she was the secretary to Myron Selznick, who was one of the big agents, David Selznick's brother. And I'd written her this kind of funny, cute letter, and she wrote me back and she said, oh, Bobby, you wrote such a nice letter, you're a writer. And I thought, well, yeah, that's what I'll do.
It never rains in sunny California.
When I got out of the Air Force, my dad was living in California. He'd rented a house in Malibu up in the hills. And so I moved into my father's house. The guy named George W. George had the downstairs apartment. I told him I'm a writer, and he said, oh, I'm going to be a director. We should do something together. So we wrote a story, and we sold it to RKO. They wouldn't let me write the screenplay. I said, well, can I come and watch the film being made? No. So I decided I'd be a playwright. I wrote a play, and I got in a car, and I was driving to New York, and I stopped in Kansas City, which is my hometown, and I ran into a guy I had known slightly in a bar, and he said, "What are you doing?" I said, "Well, I'm a film writer. I'm writing screenplays, and I lied quite a bit." And I said, "I'm on my way to New York to do my play. What are you doing?" He said, "I'm directing movies." I said, "Where?" He said, "Well, there's a place here. It's called the Calvin Company. It's an industrial film place." So I went over and I was introduced, and I lied about what I had done some more, and they hired me.
Morning, Mr. Jones.
Morning, Charlie.
You want me to fill her up today?
Yeah. And one more thing. I'm in kind of a hurry, but I'd like to get an oil change and a lube job.
My film school was working in these industrial films. I mean, I had to shoot and edit the films. So I learned all the tools. When I was at the Calvin Company, a guy whose father owned a chain of theaters in the Midwest, named Roden, wanted to make a movie, and a delinquents movie. And that's what it was called, The Delinquents. So I wrote it, and about three nights, I stayed up all night and wrote this script.
Have to go in?
Well, let's just go in for a little while. If we don't like it, we can always leave, okay?
We made it for $65,000, and it was really terrible. But Hitchcock saw that film, and he was impressed with it. So he called me in for a meeting and offered me a Hitchcock Presents.
Hello, Mrs. Gould.
What do you think you're doing?
I'm going to call her and tell her we're in love and you're not going to stop me.
So then I got an agent, and they got me this job on Whirlybirds.
You boys robbed a store and slugged the owner. Could be the same ones who killed the old man in the garage.
Killed?
Could you intercept? Over.
We'll try, Greendale.
We shot him in 2.5 days. Every 5 days, we would shoot 2 episodes. Tommy Thompson, who was my AD, would pick me up in the morning, and I'd get in the car, and I'd drive out to way out in the valley in California where we were shooting those things. And I'd say, "What are we doing today?" He'd say, "Oh, this is a thing, and the two guys are doing this, and there's a woman who's cheating on her husband, and she shot this guy, and there's some baby chickens, and they have all these eggs that are going to die unless the helicopter gets them, and there's a dilemma. Do they take the chickens, or do they solve the murder?" And I said, "Okay, I got it."
I was born and raised in California and spent a lot of time at the beach. One day, a movie company put out a call for girls who could swim, so I tried out and ended up getting the part. Getting work, and one day I got a call to play a nurse on Whirlybirds. The director was Robert Altman. He looked a little hungover. When we were introduced, he didn't say hello. He just said, "How are your morals?" And I said, "A little shaky. How are yours?" That was the beginning. We went right into a full-time relationship. I never worked again after Whirlybirds. He had already been married twice, but those marriages didn't last very long. And he had 3 kids, Christine, Michael, and Stephen, from those earlier marriages, and I had Connie from mine. they got married, we moved. And my new school was having this big father-daughter dance, and I was so new and completely terrified. Even though Bob and I didn't know each other that well, he came with me as my father. He was so sweet about it. He just wanted me to be happy. Soon after we were married, we had Bobby. We bought a house. It was a great house. We had lots and lots of parties. Bob loved to throw a party.
Started in Bonanza and the Roaring Twenties and a lot of those series. And I became one of the top television directors.
The more television he did, the more he realized all these TV scripts he was given were just the same old thing over and over. By the time he was doing combat, he tried to use his own experience in the war to make the show more true to life. He did one episode where Vic Morrow was shell-shocked, but that got him into trouble.
Joey? My brother, Joey, he's dead. And it's all my fault.
Is this guy out of it? Walking down the road carrying a dead German and thinking it's his brother.
A man named Selig Seligman produced that series, and he forbade me to make that. He said, I don't want you to do that. And then he went out of town, and I didn't have a decent script to go in with, and so we did it. And when he saw it, I was fired. And to edit that show, the editor would come over. There was a bar over there on in Washington Boulevard over by MGM. And I would go sit in the bar, and Vic Morrow would go to the editor and then come and sit with me. And he says, here's what he's doing. I said, well, tell him to do so-and-so and so-and-so. Then Vic would go back, and then that episode got quite a bit of attention. I think it won an Emmy.
He continued to push for more realism in all of his shows, but the producers wouldn't go for it. In an episode of Kraft Suspense Theater, we wanted to cast a black actor as a convict on the run. And when the sponsor refused the idea of a black character, he quit television and badmouthed the sponsor.
I felt that I had just done all I could do in television, and I felt I'd better leave.
What does Altman-esque mean? Playing the long shot.
After burning his bridges in television, Bob wanted to write and direct his own films. He thought that would give him more creative freedom. Around that time, we adopted Matthew, and our family grew. But we were running out of money. When you have 6 children and can't pay the milkman, that's pretty bad. It was our 5th anniversary, and he told me, for our anniversary, we are flying to Las Vegas for the weekend. So get ready. I'm just going to run out to the racetrack and I'll meet you at the airport at 6. Later, I found out he had our last $200 in his pocket, and he bet it all on a 20-to-1 long shot. And he won. When we landed in Las Vegas, he went directly to the crap table and won another $6,000. But if it had gone the other way, I might not be here to tell you this story.
The first film I did after years of television was a thing called Countdown at Warner Brothers. They sent it to me, and I liked the story. It was about going to the moon. But Jack Warner was very reluctant to hire me. He thought I was a bit of a smartass. He told me so. I went up to his office and sat there, and he said, listen, everybody wants to put you on this picture. And so I told him they can do what they want, but I got to tell you, you're going to fail. He said, I don't like your work. I don't think you get it, and I don't think you'll do a good job on this, but I'm going to let you do it. And so I said, well, I hope I can prove you're wrong.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 5.
At the launch, there was some arcing, and you're losing electrical power. There's no way to repair it without a risk of the retros firing and sending you out of trajectory. You'd never get back.
What?
Jack Warner was out of town, and the last day of shooting, he came back, and the phone rang, and it was Bill Conrad, who was the producer of this little movie, and he said, listen, don't come in Monday because Jack, they won't let you in the studio. Jack Warner called for your dailies, and he ran them Sunday, and he's barred you from the lot. And I said, what do you mean he's barred me from the lot? I have the Directors Guild. I get my first cut. He says, you can do any of that legal stuff you want, and they'll let you do it if that's what you want to do, but nobody's going to look at what you do. And it's all going to be changed. And he said, if you want to hear what he says, that fool, meaning me, has actors talking at the same time.
2 days more and we could have had an unbeatable edge.
I know. Now, those men should have been brought in, told.
I couldn't bring them all in. They don't trust
you. Just can't side deals. You can't get off the latest edition, but it's on the wire. We could kill it.
It's too late. It's out. But Mr. Nobody is calling from Washington.
I was just trying to get the illusion of reality. So I got fired from that because of overlapping dialogue.
Almanesque. Making your own rules.
Prime Minister Pierre Elliott Trudeau, speaking with church leaders today, said U.S. conscientious objectors to the war in Vietnam have his complete sympathy, and that Canada should be a refuge from militarism.
No time left for you.
Bob found backing for an independent film to be shot in Canada, that cold day in the park.
Action.
He loved Canada and talked about moving there. He was mad at America because of the Vietnam War. So I got the documents together and was trying to sell the house, but then Ingo came into the picture. Ingo Preminger was a talent agent who had a script he wanted to produce. Ingo thought Bob would be perfect for it after he saw a short film that Bob had made about smoking pot. Everyone in town had turned it down, but Bob saw something in that script that no one else saw.
I talked to Ingo Preminger for 2 hours, and I said, if you want to make the picture I want to make, I'll do it. Here's what I want. Here's what I see. And he said, okay, let's go.
Through early morning fog I see visions of the things to be. The pains that are withheld for me, I realize and I can see that suicide is painless.
Fox did not want it to be a Vietnam thing. the war was still going on in Vietnam. So they did not want to, the studio did not want to come out with that kind of picture.
The most spectacular film ever made.
I don't think I would have gotten away with this, except that Fox at the time had two other war films going on. So they were concerned about those. And I was aware of that, and I said, I've got to go on the back lot there and keep a low profile and not draw attention, have nobody pay attention to me.
Kelly Gould.
Hi.
How do you do? This is Bill Atlantic, who is Harry Hammerman, Don Sutherland, playing what, Hawkeye?
We were a little minor film. We didn't have any stars in it. I went up to San Francisco. There was a theater company up there, one of those improvisational companies, and I hired most of them as incidental players. It was taking a ensemble cast and doing it in a humorous way.
I think you all will find these accommodating. They're quite dry. Don't you use olives?
Olives? Where the hell do you think you are, man?
Dear God, protect our supreme commander on the field.
Frank, were you on this religious kick at home, or did you crack up over here?
I'm married.
I'm married. I'm happy. I love my wife. If she was here,
too.
I would be with her.
I wonder how a degenerated person like that could have reached a position of responsibility in the Army Medical Corps.
He was drafted.
We had a script which we used as a blueprint, and as we would rehearse, it would evolve. If something occurred to us that seemed to work, we would do it.
Now, when Bomer starts coming over here like he's hurt, Scotty, when he gets over to you, we'll give you a spot when you're in. You'll say, for God's sakes, Bomer, this is, get back in the game. Here's nothing. And he says, I've got the ball. And then you say, you've got the ball, we'll run. And you say, you've got the ball, he's got the ball.
We were working for the laughs, and yet there was a reality to it. People died.
Scorch, I need some more sponge.
Give me
Okay.
Give me some big hunks of sponge or something, Colonel.
Also, some big sponges. You have to use.
Oh, it's bleeding. That's got to come out of there. I can't stop that bleeding down there. Really, see, it's like the Mississippi River down there. Big, honey.
Nurse, you got a clamp, please?
Yes, sir.
I'll scratch my nose. Just down here. There. A little harder, please.
Scorch, I need some more
sponge.
Daryl Zanuck, who was the head of Fox, was in Europe while this was being made. He came back, and we had a screening for him. And in this screening, he had come back from Europe, and he had two young European girls that were friends of his. And they came to this screening. And at the end of the screening, he said, all that blood has to come out. And I thought, oh, Christ, we're sunk. And those girls said, oh, Daryl, that's the best part of it. And they just supported that in such a way that we were allowed to leave them in for a preview. And that audience went nuts. And Zanuck said, we're not going to mess with this. The picture was such a hit, it was phenomenal. I mean, you know, with the war going on, the timing worked.
International Festival, Cannes, 1970, MASH, États-Unis.
Le réalisateur Robert Altman.
Altman-esque. Life, liberty, and the pursuit of truth.
We welcome 15th man after Direct MASH, Mr. Robert Altman.
My son wrote that song.
Your son wrote that song?
When he was 14. Suicide is painless. Now he's got so much money. He's 16. He's living with a 20-year-old girl in Venice.
Shocking. Do you get any kick now out of the fact that you're a hot director and there are all those years when people wouldn't expectorate on you?
Oh, yeah.
Do you?
Yeah.
How does that come out?
It's fun.
Yeah.
It's nice.
Became the hottest director in Hollywood, and we built what I called a movie star house in Malibu. It was a new life for our family. Everyone wanted Bob to do MASH 2, but Bob refused to repeat himself. Instead, he surprised everyone by making a far-out little film called Brewster & Cloud.
It was an important time in the 70s because the studio turned filmmaking back to the artists. So I got to do a lot of stuff that was certainly not the formula that had existed before. McCabe's script was given to me right after I made MASH. The reason I liked it was the standard Western genre. We just twisted it a little bit.
McCabe and Mrs. Miller is a beautiful pipe dream of a movie, a fleeting, almost diaphanous vision of what frontier life might have been like. It's not much like other Westerns. It's not really much like other movies. The fact is that Altman is dumping square conventions that don't work anymore. All those threadbare remnants of the well-made play which American movies have clung to. What this movie reveals is that there's poetry in Robert Altman, and he's able to put it on the screen. The question is always asked, why aren't there American Bergmans and Fellinis? Here is an American artist who has made a beautiful film. We were in Canada, we went to Ireland. Bob liked to shoot as far away from the studios as possible, so he wouldn't have executives looking over his shoulder.
Yeah.
I just stopped here because it's a good wide place in the road, and I figured we can round it over here and mount it. It also looks like there's bad weather over there.
I think we've got to go someplace.
Well, either direction here. I thought while they're mounting the car, I'll drive up this way and drive up that way, see where the weather's the worst.
I got out of that damn car so they could get it up the hill, and I said I would walk. And they took them, so I ran up that fucking hill.
Remember last night?
Mm-hmm. Now the kiss again. Long as you do it, you right into it. Okay. And that's when you respond, because now you're going tricky. Yeah, that's it. Stand by. Sleep.
Hello, is your name Mrs. Altman?
Yes, it is.
Oh, well, I'd like to ask you a few questions about filming. How did you meet your husband?
I met him in Hollywood on a television series called Whirlybirds.
Oh.
He was directing it at the time.
Oh. And, how do you like being married to a film director?
Oh, I find it very, very interesting. Very unusual life and very full of surprises day by day.
Yeah. And also I hear that your children are they're starting to like filming.
Yes, they're getting very involved. I may end up with four little boy directors.
Action.
Thank you. Bob was constantly innovating, and in the 1970s, he developed a casual style that was radically different from Hollywood filmmaking at the time.
Mr. Merle, the lights in your car are on.
Oh, yeah. Thanks a lot.
Excuse me, I don't see any Curry brand cat food.
The what?
Curry brand cat food. It happens to be the only kind of food. Yeah, Curry Brand, C-O-U-R.
Oh, we're all in there. Curry Brand. Why don't you get this, mister? All this shit is the same anyway.
Oh, yeah? You don't happen to have a cat by any chance,
What do I need a cat for? I got a girl.
Uh-huh.
On the long goodbye, the camera never stopped moving. Dollying, zooming. He wanted the action to be caught as if by accident. He hated things being mastered, two-shot, hit your mark, say your line. He wanted the feeling to be natural and more relaxed, observational.
Okay, Eileen, what was Marty Augustine doing here the other night?
How did you know?
My father and he are from my place, so he dropped by to have a word or two with me, and I was just curious to see who else he wanted to talk to. It turned out to be you.
Oh, Marty Augustine owed him some money, maybe $10,000 or something like that.
He owes Marty. And you know what he told me? He told me Marty owed him.
Well, you heard what Dr. Verringer said. He hates to part with money.
You know what Dr. Verringer said? I heard a lot of people said that Terry Lennox was working for Marty Augustine.
I don't believe it.
Yeah, well, that's what I heard. Your husband ever talk about the Lennoxes?
No.
Ever talk about Sylvia Lennox?
No.
Is your husband having an affair with Sylvia Lennox?
Mr. Marlowe, I don't wish to continue this conversation about my husband.
Yeah, well, was your husband having an affair with somebody you didn't know who might have been Sylvia Lennox?
Definitely not.
Where was your husband the night Sylvia Lennox was killed?
Bob's other big innovation was in sound. The traditional way of recording sound was to have a single boom mic over the main actors' heads. But that didn't work very well when you had a big ensemble cast.
Damn it, that last song that went off the table was a joke. That's why you wouldn't give it up.
You are ridiculous.
You said it wasn't even close.
Yesterday's news.
You were working together. You partners. You two motherfucking creeps of
darkness.
They've been consistent winners, and I'm a big loser, and you know I know how to play poker.
Oh, sour grapes, honey, sour grapes.
All right, let's get it back to normal.
How's it, punk? You're not that good.
Oh, up yours.
In California Split, he invented a way to use radio mics and 8-track recorders to simultaneously record each actor's lines on separate channels, so that he could patrol them in the mix. He wanted to give the audience the feeling they were in a real place, and force them to choose which conversation to listen to.
A dollar. Says you don't know who Glenn Riggs is.
Well, I'd be like a bit
glass. What's
your answer? I'll bet you on that.
Hey, Ben, Glenn Riggs was the announcer.
What do you want, $30?
$30.
What's
that?
I'm only at least that time, and I don't go. I can't take
it. It's the
day. Jack went to a funeral.
Right.
I've been working here for 1 year, right? Just give me this paper, Chip. $30 for me.
I give you $30 and I come up short.
Maybe you were born short, and it's always
Captain Midnight.
Now everyone records that way, but he was the first. His films just didn't look or sound like anyone else's, and they still don't.
Doc, that's what. Dopey, still Snoopy. There is no Snoopy.
There ain't no Snoopy.
Altman-esque. Showing Americans who we are.
He was working on Thieves Like Us in Mississippi, a beautiful little film that Joan Tewksbury wrote for him. Joan had worked as a script supervisor on McCabe. Bob, you know, would always discover talent and give people opportunities. Anyway, after she wrote Thieves Like Us, Bob asked her to go to Nashville and keep a journal of what she saw. Well, she landed at the airport, got into a car, and the first thing she saw was a car crash on the highway. It kept her stuck for 2 hours. And that's how Bob opened the picture.
When the weather kills your cry, keep a going. Why it takes work to reach the top, keep a going.
It was a multi-layered story with characters who crisscrossed each other in the country music scene. But Bob thought it lacked something.
Country music radiates a love of this nation, patriotism. Country music, therefore, has those combinations which are so essential to America's character at a time that America needs character.
At the time, the whole Watergate thing was happening, and he hated Nixon. So he added a political angle.
On the first Tuesday in November, we have to make some vital decisions about our management. Let me go directly to the point. I'm for doing some replacement.
I still love my mom and daddy best in Idaho. My mom and daddy, thank you.
Don't take it easy now. This isn't Dallas, it's Nashville.
Oh, man,
this is Nashville. You show them what we're made of. They can't do this to us here in Nashville.
Somebody let me see. I can help you.
Sing. Sing.
I think you've been hurt.
Oh.
Oh, man, I can't stop that blood, man.
Come on, I'm gonna sing. It don't worry me. It don't worry me. You may say I ain't free. You don't worry me. Oh, don't worry me. You don't worry me. You may say I ain't free. You don't worry me. You don't worry.
It seems like so many of your films have a tendency to explode American myths and genres, and I just wondered, what's your perception of American society?
She says, am I exploding the myths and are taking shots at America and our culture? If that's the result of it, that's the result of it. But what I'm doing is simply reflecting what I see and feel. I live here. I was born here. I love this country. I love this. All I know, it's my culture, and I just try to show what I see. If it's ugly, that's what I see.
Altman asks, what does it mean?
Creating a family. By the mid-70s, Bob was riding his own wave. He had gathered so many talented people that he set up Lionsgate, a studio that would produce independent films to keep the people he cared about working in between his own movies. The first director he worked with was Alan Rudolph. Alan started with Bob back as a second AD on The Long Goodbye. He co-wrote Buffalo Bill and became a close friend. And Lionsgate produced his first film, Welcome to L.A. Bob's only instructions to Alan were, keep the budget low and don't make a chase movie. The way Bob did it, making films was always collaborative. His process was to bring his friends together and let the film evolve. He encouraged everyone to contribute, but for him, the most important thing was the actors.
I think the actors are the main artistic element in any film. They're more important than the script, they're more important than the photography, they're more important than the director, because they're the ones that do it. So the more you can make them your collaborator, then you're getting the best of all worlds. I encourage actors to feel comfortable and to know that they can go further
They can step over the edge, and I've got a safety net. I won't let them make a fool of themselves. I spend a lot of effort in trying to make a family so that the actors become a part of it. Everybody comes to the dailies. Nobody's taking notes, and there's booze, and you find these actors start rooting for each other.
Your beautiful wife, Antoinette, tells me that you are an art collector. You certainly don't look like an art collector. Well, you know, if you're walking down the street and somebody pointed you out and asked me what I thought you did and I didn't know you, I would never in a million years guess art collector. You could go on What's My Line and stump the panel.
I remember we'd have these big Thanksgiving dinners. Dad made it a lot of fun for all of us. But that and Christmas were the only times we'd be alone with him as a family. Catherine was always there for us, but Dad was always working. For the most part, we were not his priority. His movies were his priority. He loved us, but it was hard.
I did 5 films at Fox. They were done almost like independent films. Alan Ladd was running the studio then, and he was very supportive. He really stood up for me, and I owe him a lot. Grace Kelly was involved in the studio, and they had a board meeting, and she said, "How could you let this Altman person put my friend Paul Newman in such a dreadful film?" And Laddie just said, "Oh, shut up, I quit." And he got up and walked out, and that was the end of him over there.
Quintet came out, which the critics hated, and a week later, A Perfect Couple was released, which the critics hated even more. So he was having a pretty bad run at the box office. And then came Help.
I've never stepped into one of these things. I don't care about it. Mr. Altman, I thought I'd ask a couple of things about the making of this film. The title is Help.
What?
I say the title is, the title of the movie is Help, and I was going to ask you if that's a particular preoccupation of yours or just what they could call a property you're interested in.
No, I make lots of movies.
The whole subject of Help, of course, it involves a certain amount of controversy because there are stories, exposés, and so on about the food ad it is, the sort of thing that where things are advertised that aren't precisely what they claim to be, and so on. Will that be a point that you'll be trying to take satiric thrusts at in the movie, if you could talk about that a bit?
Well, we don't have a script yet.
Take one, take one. Hey, camera. All right, action.
I'm having a sugar bit.
By the time we completed Health, there was a different management at Fox. They believed it wouldn't make money. We got in a little argument, so the film was buried.
Altman-esque. Expect the unexpected.
Robert Evans saw Annie on Broadway, and he wanted to do the movie version, but he couldn't get the rights. He found out that Paramount owned Popeye, the comic strip, and he decided to make a big-budget musical of Popeye instead. After a lot of directors turned it down, for some reason, Evans sent the script to Bob. I remember seeing the script on his desk and saying to him, "Popeye?" First movie, and Bob convinced the studio to hire Shelley Duvall and Paul Paul Dooley, who was in six or seven of Bob's films. He found the Pickle Family Circus, who were all clowns and jugglers. And Sweet Pea was played by our grandson Wesley, Christine's son.
Wesley was born with kind of a crooked smile. One day, Dad noticed when Wesley smiled, he looked a lot like Popeye. He said, "See, this is where the pipe goes in." He was about 10 months old. He hadn't even learned to walk yet, and Bob had him cast as Sweet Pea. It was just one of those magical moments of how he cast people.
Okay, everybody, stand by.
The production spent millions building a village into a barren hillside. And about 3 minutes into the filming, things started to go wrong. After losing 21 days of shooting to bad weather, going several million dollars over budget, and the studio threatening to pull the plug, Bob wasn't even sure he could finish the film.
Tonight in Hollywood, Paramount and Disney unveiled their highly anticipated Christmas blockbuster Popeye. And what a scene it was!
Good morning and welcome to the Critics Corner. For years, Popeye has been one of my favorite comic strip characters. So I and millions of others have been looking forward to the big Hollywood Popeye movie with joyous anticipation. The cast looked perfect for the parts, the writer was the estimable Jules Pfeiffer, and the director was the imaginative, though inconsistent, Robert Altman. What could go wrong? Well, just about everything. And the disappointing news this morning is that Popeye is a debacle, with the characters left in ruins. First of all, Pfeiffer fails. His script as shot is undistinguished, and it is without humor. But above all, the culprit is Robert Altman, whose direction and editing are ponderous, hesitant, and almost incoherent. The members of this cast, who seem born to play these roles, have been subverted by their director. Paul Dooley, who plays the hamburger-loving Wimpy with such relish, is given nothing to do. I mean nothing. Zilch, zero, garnish, not a zip. Robin Williams has the cartoon character down, but much of his dialogue is unintelligible, and much of what is intelligible is incomprehensible. The songs by Harry Nilsson are a calamity. His music is tuneless, and his lyrics are moronic. Shelley Duvall is just wonderful. Thank goodness for Shelley Duvall. Just think of this. For years and years, Popeye has been chug-a-lugging spinach, and when he finally gets something to go with the spinach, it turns out to be a turkey.
The critics trashed it, and Bob took most of the blame. It was nowhere near the blockbuster the studios were hoping for.
The films that they want to make now, the major companies, are not... They're films that I don't want to make. Also, I can't make them. I can't make Superman and Raiders of the Lost Ark, and I don't want to. And the films I do want to make and feel that I can make, they don't want to make. I mean, they want movies now that will... there's a magic number they use, $100 million. And I just can't do that. It's just a time to split, that's all. And by splitting, I mean separate.
It was pretty rough. The phone stopped ringing. I said, well, where should I cut back, or what should I do? We could sell the house, move to New York. He was pretty down. He worried his luck had run out.
You ever bet $10,000 in a football game?
Oh, yeah.
You have?
Mm-hmm.
Do you win much?
I'm behind. This has not been... the last 3 years have not been good.
What does Altmanesque mean? I would say it means never giving up.
The fact that Bob couldn't get any movie deals didn't stop him. Pretty quickly, he found something he really wanted to do: live theater.
You know, I still don't like being touched to hell. When you extend your hand, when you really give, you lay your heart on the table and hand someone else a hammer.
Now, there might be some people who would feel that this is somewhat of a fall from grace for you after directing major films for so many years, to direct a couple of small plays, in a, not saying they're not good plays, but small plays in a small theater, off-Broadway, so to speak. Well, I think it's a step up. I did 4 or 5 theater pieces, and when I would do one, I'd say, I'm going to do another one. So to me, that was a very important, big time, high time in my life. It was experimenting. I went to the University of Michigan. I had done an opera there a couple years before, and I didn't have the money to produce a film, but I came up with a scheme of making it a course. And so all of the crew, except for a couple of us, were students, and they got a credit for doing this.
Yeah, let's just take this opening up to where he gets up and walks out of the frame on the set. All right, let's start on the monitors. Now, when he gets up to leave, make your pan to the door.
My little dog Checkers, he... They elected me not once, not twice, but all my goddamn life. And they would do it again, too, if they had the chance. I'm sure. They said they didn't trust me. They said, let Dick Nixon do it. And I did it. They said they wouldn't buy a used car for me, but they gave me the biggest vote in American history. And then they flushed me down the toilet. And they wanted me to stay down. They wanted me to kill myself. Well, I won't do it. If they want me dead, they'll have to do it. Fuck 'em! Fuck 'em! Fuck 'em! Fuck 'em! Fuck 'em!
I never met Richard Nixon in my life, but I did have a couple of exchanges with him. Once he wrote a book called Leaders, which was a really big book. And I was living in California at the time, and suddenly in the mail, this book, heavy book comes, and it was from the ex-president, and it was inscribed in there. It says, to Robert Altman, thank you for your years of loyal support. And I thought, shit, I gotta burn a book. And I really had a dilemma. I could have torn out that page, which ultimately I did, because I didn't want it to be found in my archives by one of my great-grandchildren, and then say, oh, Granddaddy was a big Nixon supporter.
C'est si bon, de partir n'importe où, par-dessus, par-dessous, en chantant des chansons, c'est si bon.
After Secret Honor, we sold the house and moved to Paris. He felt appreciated there, as so many American artists do.
Bob, remember that shower scene in Mash where you made me get naked? You get naked.
For a while now, Dad had been hiring me and my brother Bobby to work with him. I started out in props and eventually became his production designer.
This is our ace prop man, Steve Altman. Steve, do you have anything to say about the production?
And Bobby became his camera operator. Working with him, it was good. I got to see him, and I got paid.
Working out of Paris, he shot anywhere he could get a deal. Mostly small films, financed with European money or by the new U.S. cable channels, who gave him total freedom.
Come on, right around in here and just fill in and make this brief. Give me as many people on this side as I can. Michael, Cynthia, tighten on in, everybody. You got enough foreground people. We'll need some people now over in here. Kathy, come on up in here, everybody. We need some people in here around this area.
Okay, stand by, please.
Okay, action, Michael. Let there be no mistake about it. As a people of conscience, we cannot
We must not settle for anything less than a comprehensive global boycott of South Africa.
Yes. Yeah.
Michael, that was terrific. I just want to do one more, please. HBO wanted to do something about the election. So Gary Trudeau and I said, let's run a guy for president. So we did. We took Michael Murphy, who played Jack Tanner, and we created a staff and infiltrated them into actual situations.
My daughter Alex.
Hi. How are you?
Sure, carrying them up in my home state.
Well, Michigan is a strong one for me. You know that, Jack.
I'll tell you, it made me glad to be a Democrat. I wouldn't want to be up against you.
Well, the Republicans are going to be tough this year, but we wish you the best.
Looking tougher all the time.
We're about the ground rules now. The panel will direct questions to specific candidates.
What we're doing is, we don't know what to call it because it's not a documentary. It's not fictional. I call it experimental television.
We must stop the flow of drugs in this country, the number one threat on the streets of our nation today. Our borders are militarily inferior in terms of being protected from drug traffickers.
Jesse, as you may recall, it was former President Nixon who started the war on drugs, the same former President Nixon who couldn't seal off South Vietnam from North Vietnam with 500,000 troops. America's tired of being dragged into wars it can't win, and the war on drugs is a loser. And any law that makes 25 million Americans criminals is a loser. It's time to get real. The only way to get drugs off our streets is through legalization.
He said it.
There goes the street value of my stash.
I think people, with all due respect, are more than ready to elect a black president. I just don't think they're ready for you.
What did they put in his oatmeal this morning?
Hey, what kind of spin do we put on that?
Tanner 88, I think, is probably the best work that I've done. I think it's the most inventive. Because we really did change television.
This is WNBC New York. I'm Larry Stack, and here's what's happening at 2 o'clock. President Bush proposed to add an additional $1.2 billion to the budget for the war on drugs, including a 50% increase in military spending.
You've moved back to America after being based in Paris. Do you think you've changed?
I don't think I've changed. I think I just keep doing the same thing. And occasionally, what I do crosses with the general attitude of the public, and it becomes very successful. And then I'm a failure and a has-been, and then I cross back again. But I'm going straight. To me, I'm going in a straight line. Everybody else is just going like this.
Altman-esque. Kicking Hollywood's ass.
Most of the scripts that they send me are studio scripts. I mean, I'd be embarrassed to be associated with them. I don't think there's anything I could do other than radically change them, which these people don't want. I make gloves, and they sell shoes.
David Brown, the producer, told Bob that he had a project that Bob was born to direct because it struck at everything that was wrong with Hollywood. And it was true. Nobody but Bob could have pulled off the player the way he did. It gave him the chance to crucify forever Hollywood's entire way of making movies.
I know we're not supposed to meet till next week, but a lot of you come down.
That's what
we're
meeting next.
Well, yeah, I just wanted to plant the seed in your head just now, just so that, you know, it's...
So I'm booked up.
Okay, but just picture this, okay? It's a planet in the far, far future. It's a planet with two suns.
Who plays the sun?
No, suns. Large solar disks.
Listen, you gotta run this idea by Bonnie Sherman.
Pictures they make these days are all MTV. Cut, 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 cut. The opening shot of Wells' Touch of Evil was 6.5 minutes long.
6.5 minutes long?
Well, 3 or 4 anyway. He set up the whole picture with that one tracking shot. Here it is. The Graduate, Part 2.
Oh, good.
Now listen, the three principals are still with us. Dustin Hoffman, Anne Bancroft, Catherine Ross. Mm-hmm. 25 years later, and so are the characters. Ben, Elaine, and Mrs. Robinson. Ben and Elaine are married. Still, they live in a big, old, spooky house up in Northern California somewhere. And Mrs. Robinson lives with them.
Mm.
Her aging mother, who's had a stroke.
Mrs. Robinson had a stroke,
so she can't talk.
It's going to be funny?
Yeah, it'll be funny.
With
dark
a stroke?
And weird and funny and with a stroke.
TV star and she goes on like a
diaper. You're talking about a TV star and a motion picture?
No, not a real TV star. It'll be played by a star.
A movie star playing a television star.
Julia Roberts will be good. Dolly Hart will be good. Dolly.
You know, I like Goldie. I like Goldie.
Okay, great. Because we have a relationship and that would be great. Goldie goes to Africa.
Goldie goes to Africa.
She gets worshipped.
Political doesn't scare me. Radical political scares me.
Politely politically radical. But
is it funny?
It's funny. It's
a funny political thing.
It's a funny thing. It's a thriller, too.
It's a thriller.
And it's all at once.
So, what's the story?
Well, I want Bruce Willis.
Mm-hmm.
I think I can talk to him. It's a story about a senator, a bad guy senator at first. He's traveling around the country on the country's dime, you know, like that Sununu guy used to.
I see, so sort of a cynical political thriller comedy.
Yeah, but it's got a heart in the right spot.
Uh-huh.
And anyway, he has an accident.
An accident.
Yeah, and he becomes clairvoyant, like a psychic.
Oh, I see.
Yeah.
So it's kind of a psychic political thriller comedy with a heart.
With a heart. And not unlike Ghost meets Manchurian Candidate.
Go on, I'm listening.
Anyway, he can start to read people's minds, and when he gets to the president's mind, it's completely blank.
Mr. Altman, is the player your revenge against Hollywood?
No, it's a very, very mild indictment. Things aren't really like that. They're much worse.
Mr. Altman, I'd like to ask you, do you think Hollywood has lost its objectivity?
No, I think Hollywood has always maintained its objectivity, which is greed and making as much money as it can and trying to get rid of all the artists. Of course, they can't succeed in that, so since they can't really get rid of us, we just keep popping up and going along.
And now, we have the presentation of the Palme d'Or for Best Director. The Palme d'Or for Best Director goes to Robert Altman for The Player.
The Player was a huge hit in Caan. Everyone wanted to meet with him. And he finally found backers for a film he'd been wanting to do for years. Shortcuts, Bob took a collection of Raymond Carver's short stories and adapted them into one multi-layered story. I think Bob connected with Carver's stories because they're about the lives of ordinary people, the frailness of human behavior, the randomness of things that happen in life.
Yeah, baby, we're going out together.
the paper I'm making.
Wasn't the big one, no.
If we were able to explain any of these characters, it's the very fact that things happen to them and they are inexplicable, because I think that's more truthful to the way life really is.
Who the fuck are they? Jerry!
Almanesque. What does it mean?
How vulnerable we are.
Talking with Robert Altman. For what's left of you from the success of your diet, welcome.
Thank you. I'm glad that you mentioned that, because people think I'm sick.
He's ill. He's lost weight.
I've lost about 35 pounds, and I got about a few more to go, and I just figure it'll add some longevity to the because I see the light at the end of the tunnel.
The doctor said you have an enlarged heart. You shouldn't do this or that, and you shouldn't drink. But it never stopped him from doing anything.
I heard him yelling. He's like, I think we have a problem here. So he ran downstairs, and he couldn't remember my name. I called the doctor, and as I was helping him get dressed, he looks up at me and says, Connie, if this is it, it's been great. It was a microstroke.
He gave up drinking. That was hard. He said, the only thing I miss about drinking is the alcohol. He was great. He was still fun and funny, but he was thin. Prêt-à-porter was difficult. That he managed to make that movie was an accomplishment. But he kept on working.
As soon as these kids who are going through get right under here, as soon as you lose sight of them, you're going to move on over.
Kansas City came out of his memories of growing up there, especially of jazz music, which he loved. But he barely made it through that film. It was his heart. It was giving out. The doctor said, I think you need a transplant. And Bob said, what are the odds? He rested for a whole year learning how to live with a new heart and handle possible rejection and medication and a whole regimen.
I kept it quiet because I was afraid nobody would hire me, because there's such a stigma to it.
By his 71st birthday, he looked terrific. He was really with it and excited to get back to work.
I love what I do. I love the actors and what they do. And it's just such a delight to sit there and watch people create something.
and know that you're a part of it. It's just thrilling. I don't ever want to stop it.
Altman-esque? Storytelling. Masterful storytelling.
All right, well, what do you want to do? Should we just shoot one and see how bad it is? Let's shoot one. I mean, see how good it is. Let's waste film. I have a lot of stock in Eastman. All right, let's do it. Okay, action, servants.
Gosford Park was one of Bob's masterpieces, but it almost never got made. We couldn't line up the financing. It just kept falling apart. What scared the investors were the exact things he loved about it. Big ensemble cast, unresolved ending. One guy said he'd finance the film if Bob would rewrite the ending, to make it a traditional murder mystery. But Bob refused. With zero funding, no investors, he called up every A-list actor in London and said, "We're making this movie." They were like, "Absolutely, I'd love to work with you." We were close to shooting. The producers are freaking out, and Bob is totally cool, like he knows everything is going to work out. And then we got the call. The British Lottery Fund agreed to back the film. He won the lottery.
Mr. Weissman,
yes.
Tell us about the film you're going to make.
Oh, sure. It's called Charlie Chan in London. It's a detective story.
Set in London.
Well, not really. Most of it takes place at a shooting party in a country house, sort of like this one, actually. Murder in the middle of the night, a lot of guests for the weekend, everyone's a suspect, that sort of thing.
Horrid. And who turns out to have done it?
Oh, I couldn't tell you that. It would spoil it for you.
Oh, but none of us will see it.
Isabel? Isabel? Jennings?
Robert Altman's film, Gosford Park, is a virtuoso ensemble piece to rival the director's Mashko and Shortcuts, and its masterly interweaving of multiple characters and subplots. It is a contemporary equivalent of Jean Renoir's classic, Rules of the Game. What makes the achievement of Gosford Park all the more remarkable is that Mr. Altman is 76. If the movie's cool assessment of the human condition implies a dispassionate overview of a man who has seen it all, the energy that crackles from the screen suggests the clear-sighted joie de vivre of an artist still deeply engaged in the world.
I'd done 6-7 films, and I was so smug and proud of myself because I thought, none of these films are alike. And then 10-12 films more, I look at these things and I think, these really all are just chapters of the same book. They're just different chapters.
With Prairie Hill Companion, Bob was doing two things. Returning to his youth when he absolutely loved radio, and contemplating death. He was joining both ends of the circle.
What are we doing? You're on in the Powder Milk segment doing Gold Watch and Chain with him.
We haven't done that for years.
Excuse me, I gotta get a head start on getting high eye tonight. How about Red River Valley?
Fine, whatever you like.
Well, this isn't really gonna be your last show, is it?
Every show's your last show. That's my philosophy.
Thank you, Plato.
Come and sit by my side if you love me. Do not hasten to bid me adieu. But remember the Red River Valley. And the one who has loved.
A lot of people are wondering what you meant with the ending of the film when the angel goes into the diner.
And a lot of people go back and forth about what it means, what she was there
for. Well, I felt it was about leaving it open about who was going to die next. Obviously, this film is about death. And she was the angel of death, and she showed up for one of them, and we just closed the film before we told you which one, sort of like real life. Death is the only ending that I know about. People will say, oh, does this have a happy ending? I say, well, no, but we can make a happy stopping place. These get-togethers, and I would catch him sitting in a corner just looking at everybody with that grin on his face. It was like one of his movies, like he became aware that he was in his own movie, and he loved the cast.
Almanis, what does it mean to you?
It's inspiration.
Arts and Sciences is giving Altman a Lifetime Achievement Award in recognition of a career that has repeatedly reinvented the art form and inspired filmmakers and audiences alike.
Filmmaker has gotten a better shape than I have. I'm very fortunate in my career. I've never had to direct a film. I didn't choose. I love filmmaking. It has given me an entree to the world and to the human condition. And for that, I'm forever grateful. Finally, I'd like to thank my family, which you're all right there, all of them, for their love and support through the years. And most importantly, I want to thank and applaud my wife, Catherine Reed Altman, without whom I wouldn't be here today. I love you, Christopher. Thank you. Oh, one more thing. I'm here, I think, under kind of false pretenses. And I think I have to become straight with you. 11 years ago, I had a heart transplant. A total heart transplant. I got the heart of, I think, a young woman who was about in her late 30s. And so by that kind of calculation, you may be giving me this award too early, because I think I got about 40 years left on it. And I intend to use it.
pre-production on a film called Hands on a Hard Body, Scouting Locations. He'd been diagnosed with cancer, and he wanted to keep on working, chemo or no chemo. It would have been his 40th movie. One day, years and years ago, just after the war, Bob had nothing to do and he went to a theater in the middle of the afternoon to see a movie. Not a Hollywood movie, a British movie. He said the main character was not glamorous, not a babe. And at first he wondered why he was even watching it. But 20 minutes later he was in tears and had fallen in love with her. And it made him feel that it wasn't just a movie.
Let's begin again. Let's start over from the start. Let's forget the time that you nearly broke my heart. Forget about our pride. Pay attention to the way we feel inside. Let's give love a spin again. Let's begin again. We gave love a chance one time. We gave up. To make it last, let's begin again without worry.